You haven't found your way here by accident. It's a unique and meaningful connection meant to deliver the impactful message of Apostle Joshua Selman to your doorstep. This message carries the potential to not only bless you, but also inspire you for greatness. Open your heart wide and allow your mind to embrace the richness of this transformative message. Before we delve further, I extend a warm invitation for you to actively engage with this significant message. Join in by liking the video, sharing it with those in your circles who might find it beneficial, and subscribing to our channel for a consistent flow of insightful content. Your support is genuinely appreciated and plays a crucial role in our ability to continue sharing these meaningful messages. As you tune in to absorb this special message, may blessings overflow into your life. Embrace the profound wisdom offered by Apostle Joshua Selman, and let this encounter be a beacon of inspiration and positive change in your life's journey. Your openness to receiving this message can be a transformative step toward a more enriched and purposeful life.
You have tried the way of sending a text to an uncle and say, can you give me a job? You have tried the way of borrowing money and you have gotten into trouble. You have tried the way of trying to just use publicity materials to say, come to my church. These things are not wrong. You are a sincere person trying it. But I'm proposing to you tonight that God wants to give you a gift that ends ordinary living in your life. When a man accesses the wisdom of God, nothing about his life becomes ordinary again. Believe me when I tell you this. There is always a signature that he has followed a higher way. You can trek to Lagos. That is a way that leads to Lagos. You may arrive, you may not arrive. You can use a bike to go to Lagos. You can use a car and go to Lagos. And perhaps you may be a victim of armed robbers on the way. Perhaps because of bad road or bad weather, it can affect you. Perhaps something can happen to the tire. There can be a mechanical fault. Are we together? But then you can take a flight. That is another route. That someone can be on his bed, sleeping, and you tell him goodbye. I'm going to Lagos. And he says, I'll wait for you there. And you leave in the morning, and later on in the afternoon, he just stretches himself and jumps into an aircraft. And in 50 minutes exactly, he's landed in Lagos. And you still find him still sleeping in another location while you're on your way going. The difference is not the sincerity of your heart. You are both sincere people, but you have chosen different routes based on the resources available. Are we together now? Listen very carefully. So the man who is on the road sweating, imagine a woman with 3 or 4 children, all making noise and disturbing everybody in the car, but you are limited to that based on the resources you have. Then the driver can decide to park by 9 o'clock and say he feels there are armed robbers. If you are courageous, come and carry the car and take the other people to Lagos. Or the driver can say, I am tired. I either drive, sleep on the way and kill all of you, or we are patient till 5 o'clock before we continue the journey. He will just apologize. But many things now are at risk because you could not get there at the time you wanted to. Two things. The method of transportation you chose, that is a reflection of the resources within you. Are we together now? Whereas another person, you can find children jumping in the plane, disturbing people, but they are still going at that pace because their parents made a choice for them and they are benefiting from that choice. Crying but on their way, 50 minutes exactly, and they're in Lagos. They arrive there, and you can have the time, you can arrive happy, people greet you, they are cautious on your way home. What is the difference? Now, I'm not from a physical standpoint, I'm not looking down on this too. I hope you understand me. I'm just showing you the superiority of the routes, trying to contrast what the Lord has said. You can choose a path to life that makes people hate Jesus by looking at your life. Now, God will honor you because you use your will to choose that choice, to make that choice. And so it's a life of hardship, a life of struggling, up and down, pain, no victory, one battle after the other for the rest of your life. Or you can make up your mind and say, I have spent 25 years of my life trying this route. I have spent 30 years of my life trying this route. Now I want to choose a more superior path the way of the Lord, the way of wisdom, and then you align with God's way, ladies and gentlemen, you can take a flight with God that in no distant time you can arrive in ministry, arrive in life. You see, there is nothing like too late with God. Too late is relative to the path you take. Are we together now? Now, do you know, as powerful as flight is, even in physics, there is something called telepathy, where you disappear, you are not, and you are in a moment. At least your sci-fi movies have it, and then the Bible also tells us a few men who manifested that. Are we together? You are not, and then you are in a moment. That is a possibility with God, that a man can walk with God and choose that level of wisdom, and that by the next moment, God does something in your life that people will have to call you and say, listen, I do not know you going to herbalists. I do not know you collecting charms. What is responsible for this kind of result? And you tell them, no, I didn't meet a herbalist. I found out that there is a level of wisdom that can come. Ah, please believe me. Please believe me. You do ministry with that wisdom, get ready to soar in a flight where your life becomes an inspiration to many. You ignore that wisdom and see how hard your life will be, and see how much of pain you will accumulate all through your lifetime. When God wants to help you, let me repeat myself for your understanding. Number one, He reveals His will, because if you are outside the will of God, I've told you that the power of God cannot support you in defiance to the will of God. Then number two, you need the wisdom of God. I have taught you that in scripture there are four kinds of wisdom. There is wisdom that comes from above. There is sensual wisdom, wisdom that is scientific. Number three, there is natural wisdom, wisdom that is a product of age and experience, instinct. And then there is devilish or demonical wisdom. We are talking here about superior wisdom that is from above. You want to build anything great in your life? That is a kind of wisdom that must come upon your life. You want to make acceleration and progress in life and destiny? That is the kind of wisdom. I have discovered that many people who come to church are not really sick in terms of bodily deformities, but most people are in need of strange solutions, solutions that cannot be found by the wisdom of God. The wisdom of man. It will take superior wisdom. How do I move from where I am to the next level of my life? Most of the prayer requests here, I have taught you that most prayer requests of members carry financial issues, then perhaps health issues, and then various issues that require solutions. Solutions in office, solutions in your life and destiny, how to bring yourself from point A to point B. The believer was not left without wisdom from God. Please listen carefully. It would be a dangerous thing, and it would be unfair for God to put us in this complicated world that is made up of all kinds of people and then give everybody a will and yet not grant us access to superior wisdom. Being a sign and a wonder, I wrote here, demands an encounter with the wisdom of God and the power of God. Being a sign and a wonder demands an encounter with the wisdom of God and the power of God. Being a sign and a wonder demands an encounter with the wisdom of God and the power of God. There are many people who have encountered the power of God correcting all kinds of things in your body, but most people have not accessed superior wisdom. And let me tell you the truth, wisdom is connected to mighty works. Behind every extraordinary manifestation through the life of the saints is this mysterious wisdom of God. Show me a man who has accessed the wisdom of God or have mastered the dynamics of drawing forth wisdom from God. I show you a man whose life will be an unending wonder. Everything that the Bible shows as a result of the works of God, he credits it to his wisdom. He says, how mighty, manifold are your works. In wisdom thou hast made them all. Most believers are bankrupt of wisdom. We have education, because you went to school and you passed through a system, learned along a field of study, and you were certified. And with all due respect, most people believe that their life will magically change because they are holding certificates in their hands, or their lives will magically change because they are people of wonderful, maybe, character, and that is important, or their lives will magically change because they feel they are old enough to get a job or old enough to make progress. In light of the decadence in our world, in light of the sentiments and the prejudices in our world, none of these things have the power in themselves to give you an edge. The edge of the believer in this bedeviled world is access to the will of God, access to the wisdom of God, and access to the power of God. You want to become a sign and a wonder, includes your church, your family, your children, your endeavor. You are going to have to tap into a higher way. There is a way that seemeth right unto a man, the Bible says, but the end thereof are the ways of death. Listen, I submit to you with all humility. I look at my life today and I look at the bits that God has done and is doing in my life and this ministry, and it can only be the wisdom of God. I can tell you points in my walk with God where I will show you how to tap that wisdom shortly. But when that wisdom comes, like a visitor knocking at your door, you know that with that wisdom, victory has come. With that wisdom, a solution has come. Until his word came, the Lord tried him. You remain until the word comes. But when it does come, you have found your way out of any situation. Do you believe what I'm telling you? Because I'm saying that because many of you right now, most of your prayer point is shrouded in one word: confusion. What do I do? How do I know what I want? I know what I desire. I know how to move from point A to, I know that I should move from point A to point B. But how in the world am I going to cross this Red Sea? How in the world am I going to leap over a wall? How in the world am I going to run through a troop that midwives where I am and my place of destiny? The answer is found in the wisdom of God. This is the Jesus the nations are looking for. This is the Jesus that both the rich and old will see the need of him. The kind of Jesus that only the poor need is not the real Jesus. The kind of Jesus that only the rich need is not the real Jesus. When Jesus is presented properly, all men will run to him. Because the one thing the poor and the rich need together is love. They may have wealth, the rich, and the poor may lack wealth, but no man can resist the power of love. That's why it was love that defeated hell, sin, Satan, and the grave. Number two, why did Jesus come? Number two, he came to make the life of God accessible to man by reconciling man to God. Please write that down. The second assignment of Jesus when he walked upon the earth was to make the life of God accessible to man by reconciling man to God. He came to make the life of God accessible to man. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Victory Life, are we still here? That whosoever, someone shout whosoever. Let the devil hear you say whosoever. When it has to do with the life of God, whosoever, Igbo, Yoruba, Hausa, whosoever, cultist, prostitute, whosoever, provided you believe in him. There are certain things that were not given to all. The Bible says he gave unto some apostles, he gave unto some prophets. Are we together? But when it has to do with the life of God, he desires everybody, including your old grandfather. I know he's 85, but he's still part of those in that list. Whosoever believeth on him should not perish but have life everlasting. John chapter 10 and verse 10, Jesus was speaking and he said, the thief cometh not but for to steal. Please hear me, believers. To kill and to destroy. But he said, I am come. My manifesto. This is why I'm, that means every time you see me, these are the things you should be thinking about. Life. Every time you see me, life. If you are sick and I show up, life. Defeated and I show up, life. And he says, I am come to give you that life and to have it more abundantly. Amplified says, to its fullest. Life. That means anything that looks like death is an attack. You don't need to ask if it's the will of God. Poverty, an expression of death. Sickness, an expression of death. Limitation, an expression of death. Not having the ability to take care of your children. Don't ask if it's the will of God. It is that Jesus said, I have come. Verify the things happening around you by my manifesto. If they do not look like things administer life, he's saying fight it, no matter how long, fight it. The devil will deceive you and make you look like I think it's just God. It's a lie. He said, I am come. If you see me, know that my ministry is to give life.
You are the one that we praise.
Listen, if you know this as a preacher, listen, it will guide the kinds of sermons you will preach. Once you mount the pulpit, now I'm speaking to the body of Christ. You know immediately, if you claim you love Jesus, the theme of your ministry must be life. At the end of your ministration, the dead should come back, spiritually, emotionally. Are we together now? Everything that leaves people dead and keeps people dying is partnership with Satan. That someone is in this place right now. You came diagnosed that you have cancer and you just strolled into church because they told you that God is there. If it is true that God is there, what is the proof? Back to Jesus. Where two or three are gathered in my name, he said, I am there. So I know he's there not because of any cloud. I know he's there not because I fell down when I stood up. Jesus already told us that the moment you have two or three gathered in his name, that there is an assurance beyond the realm of feelings that he is there. Are we together? And if he's there, then you connect it to John 10:10. Why is he there? I am come. I am come for this convention. I am come to your family. That the moment a father and a mother, a husband and a wife and the children hold hands, the moment they say, Lord, we thank you for your presence, everybody's thinking life. The life giver has arrived. The life giver has arrived. The one who will help us pay the bills has arrived. The one who will take away shame. Let them keep laughing while we invite him, provided we can get him to come. Listen. This is my spiritual orientation as I minister to people. I will never minister to a people and not minister life. Because number one, his manifesto is to be an expression of the life of God. Are we together now? It doesn't matter in what form or fashion the sermon comes. Whether it comes as a rebuke, as a correction, as an admonishment, as an exegesis of scripture, the end point must be life. If I rebuke you of sin and I leave you there, I misrepresented Jesus. I must go past it and show you that after now rebuking you, there must be life. If I tell you being poor is not the way and I leave you there, I misrepresented Jesus. Because the giving you the revelation that you are poor, you are already aware. Your pain is enough information that you are in that state. I must show you the biblical pathway to life. Everything that is pro-life is worthy of being taught in church, provided it reveals Jesus. Prosperity, increase, consecration, holiness, the revelation of Jesus, spiritual growth. Are we together now? Everything that can reveal Jesus and can reveal his abundant life must be taught the saints. This is why he gave unto some apostles and prophets and teachers and evangelists and pastors for the maturing of the saints.
Is somebody learning? Next time they ask you, why did Jesus come? Know that he came to give life. And in order of priority, spiritual life is his first port of call. I have taught, and you may have heard me teach it, the greatest need of an unbeliever is salvation. Everywhere you see an unbeliever, no matter what you give that unbeliever, pocket money, a house, rent, advice, counsel, treatment, just know that you only solve temporal problems. This is the orientation every Christian must have. The moment you see an unbeliever, at the back of your mind, your ultimate project on that man will be to bring him to the kingdom. Whether he's a driver, whether he's your cook, whether he's a barber. So when you interact with unbelievers, it doesn't mean you harass everybody every day and everywhere, but you know at the back of your mind that my project on this man is not complete until he receives the life of God. If believers had this orientation, the statistics I gave you would have been covered long enough. Most believers do not know why Jesus came. So when most believers say, I want to serve Jesus, they do not know that what they are supposed to be understanding by that statement is, I want to be an extension of the reason why he came. The assignment of every believer in the life of an unbeliever is to get that person to become a believer. Are we together? The greatest need you may have heard me say of an unsaved person is salvation. The greatest need of a saved person is transformation. The greatest need of a transformed person is empowerment. The greatest need of an empowered person is purpose. This is how it works in the kingdom. So when you see someone who is not saved, your first assignment is to get him to encounter the God of the Bible, beyond a man of God, beyond a church, the God of the Bible through Jesus. When that person becomes saved, your next project is to submit him to the ministry of the word, scripture, the ministry of the Holy Spirit, and the ministry of a teaching priest. According to Jeremiah 3:15, that I will give you pastors or shepherds according to my heart. It is the reason why we took out time to salute the man of God and his wife. We salute the investments that have been made to mature the believers to this point, including organizing such a conference like this, because it's intended to still upgrade your understanding and help you to be of greater stature spiritually. But when believers are transformed alone, they become frustrated because they know what should happen, but the grace to make it happen is not there. Transformation ends with the quality of the information you have. You need empowerment. It's why when Jesus was done teaching them after 3.5 years, he says, you know what to say, but don't go yet. Tarry until power comes on your message. Otherwise, you'll be frustrated. And then when you are empowered without purpose, it becomes destructive. It's like a car that has fuel, tires working fine, and you fire it with no direction. Is someone learning? The second reason Jesus came was to grant us access to the life of God. Someone shout, I have a life of God. That's if you are born again. No, if you are not born again, as I make the altar call, just run and come and stand here. Are we together? If you have the life of God, say, I have the life of God. Let me ask you a very interesting question. How are you sure you have the life of God? You just said you have the life of God. How are you sure you are not lying? You see that now? You must have persuasion and confidence. If I random pick anybody now and I said, my dear, do you have the life of God? You say, yes. I say, why? You say, the Bible says so. Yes, you are right, but that's not enough reason. How are you sure you have the life of God? It's the same question saying, how are you sure you have eaten and you are full? You see that now? Yes. The things we have seen, the things we have handled, even of the word of life. Because the Bible says, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Is that in your Bible? It says in Romans chapter 10 from verse 9 and 10, that if you confess with your heart, your
with your mouth the lordship of Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Is that true? He says, for with the heart man confesses, man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. If you have not gone through that process, you are not saved. Period. For those who are involved in sea adventures and voyage and in geography, there is what they call the true north. That whenever you are lost at sea, your first assignment is to determine the true north. If you can find the true north, no matter where you are, you will be able to, through from that standpoint, whoever wants you to be lost at sea will cripple your capacity to find the true north. Because if you can find the true north, you can know where you are. Jesus is that true north. You want to know how right culture is? Gauge it against Jesus. You want to know how right the educational system of the world is? Gauge it against Jesus. You would be learning shortly that a believer is not just one who has surrendered his life to Jesus. A believer is one who has subscribed to Jesus as the thoughts of God, the logos of God, not just as a person. That your entire life is governed by a, permit me to use, a philosophy. So when people ask for your opinion, you really don't have an opinion. You are already bound by a thought that your life should roll. Are we together now? So when you ask me whether I like something or not, it's not whether I like it or not. It's about the position that Jesus reveals concerning that matter. This is a believer's life. This will cure the various confusions that plague our world today. When people ask me opinions about many things, I tell them, as a person, my opinions can vacillate based on culture, my experience, and so on and so forth. Are you seeing that now? But when Jesus becomes your reference, it is not about what you like or don't like. It is not even about right or wrong. It is what is in Jesus or not. Did you get that now? Jesus came as a correction. Now, the Bible says the Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. We have a right to doubt that word until that scripture is verified in Jesus. What did Jesus do when he saw sick people? Did he pass them? That means God loves. We can now say it is true that God loves because we saw Jesus living out that love life. Are we together? When God, you say God is holy and he hates sin, you have a right to doubt it until you check Jesus. He was a man tempted in all ways, yet without sin. When he entered the temple and he saw abuses of the temple, he reacted. That was the thoughts of God. That is God's opinion about any abuse in his temple. Did you get that now? Jesus came, please do not forget this. Jesus came as a reference and a correction to our idea about God. So when the Bible says a lying spirit came from God, with all due respect to those who wrote it, we now have the audacity by grace through the lens of Jesus to correct that statement. Because the Bible tells us, John chapter 1 answers it, full of grace and truth. Grace and truth. There is no variableness nor shadow of turning. It's not that God cannot lie. God does not lie. He cannot lie. Are we seeing that? So we know that something was wrong with the experience of the prophet who captured that vision. We must commend them for at least documenting what they saw. This is the reason why God gave us the Holy Spirit, even though we still have the Bible, because revelation is progressive. Are we learning? God loves, but how much does he love? Study Jesus. How far did Jesus go to prove the love of God? Greater love had no man than this, than a man laid down his life. Is that true? You say the Lord is my shepherd. You can say that scripture is a lie until you study how Jesus walked with his disciples. Was he careless? Did he leave them? When he was at the sea and the sea was about to capsize, you know, the boat, they woke him up and he got up and did something about it. Then we can trust that God is a good leader. That means he's a father enough for me to trust my life. Are we together now? That everything the Bible says about God, you have a right to doubt it until you verify it using the lens of Jesus. The first assignment of Jesus on the earth was to be a correction. Correction. This is the reason why nations train and send ambassadors. Ambassadors are mandated, they are vested with the responsibility of not just promoting bilateral relationships, but defending the interests of the nations. And in doing so, their first assignment is to give a worthy presentation of that nation. Am I right on that? Yeah. They preserve everything that makes that nation admirable, their culture, their intelligence, whatever it is. When Jesus walked upon the earth, all he was projecting was the Father. Because until that time, the people had a mixed understanding about the Father. I hope you know that when Jesus came, the nation of Israel were under bondage. They did not understand, who is this covenant God that says, I have loved you with an everlasting love, and I have drawn you with my loving kindness, and is happy watching us go through the torture of the Roman government. And when Jesus came, when he saw the woman who was bound 18 years, he said, ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham? In other words, if you want to understand my ministry here, make reference to what I told Abraham. He kept referring them to the things that God said. Number two, let's hurry up. What's the second assignment of Jesus? My life changed when I understood this. I study God from the lens of Jesus, and he redefined God for me. If someone comes and prophesies to you now, not to be sarcastic, even if I'm the one, if I look at you and say you die tomorrow, you have a right to not be afraid and judge my prophecy, including my ignorance, from the lens of Jesus. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. You see, and it is written, is greater than I saw. So your knowledge of Jesus, listen to me, it may not be that the person lied, it may even be that that's what Satan had in plan for you. But because of your knowledge of God through Jesus, are we together now? That he came as a life-giving spirit. That gives you a lot of comfort. Jesus himself gave the story of the prodigal son. That means if you have a child and the devil is telling you your child will not amount to anything, you learn how God works by studying that story. And you know that no matter how far, even if it's 10 years my child has gone home, my intercession will be worth it, because prodigal children can return home. Listen, you have to build your spiritual orientation from the portrait of the person Jesus. Because religion has a portrait it wants to sell to you. Culture, with all due respect, has a portrait it wants to sell to you. Are we together? And if you have a mix of all these portraits, the picture of God you will have is an ugly deity seated on the throne with horns, desiring to destroy you. You can re-edit that portrait with the intelligence of an artist. Remove the things that are not there, and you have the beautiful picture of a loving Father. Many believers live in fear. Many believers cannot walk with God because there is a misrepresentation of God that was sold to them. If you're understanding me, say amen. Amen. It is the reason why when we make altar calls, we make it with audacity, because we know the one who is about to receive you. The one who can leave 99 for the sake of one. Are we together now? It is the reason why when we make an altar call, we start clapping from the first person who comes. Because every single soul that stands is worth the blood of that Jesus. When you know this as a man of God, you will not frown if you make an altar call and two people come. The devil will not tell you you feel like a failure. Ask him, can you die for the two people? Do you have enough compassion to have died for the two people? The man today we call Billy Graham of blessed memory. It was such an altar call. The pastor who got him saved, he felt discouraged and felt he had failed in ministry. And one day he shouted, like I'm speaking to you now, and makes an altar call. And only one small boy just trolls out, and the man felt like a total failure. Help me guess the name of that one small boy. Billy Graham. He did not know that nations had come out for that altar call. Is someone learning? Jesus came as a correction. I want you to read the life of Jesus. Take it as a project. Study the Gospels. Jesus called himself. He called himself the true vine. John 15:15. I am the true vine. I like this. I am the true vine. John 15 verse 1, my apologies. And then verse 5. John 15, 1 and verse 5. Please correct that. I am the true vine. Can I give you three more? Number 8. I like this one. Now we leave the Gospels and we go to Revelation, where John is caught up in the Isle of Patmos and Jesus continues speaking. There he calls himself, I am Alpha, Omega, beginning and ending. Now, I don't know how a man would describe himself that way, but this is Jesus for you. Alpha, Omega, beginning and the ending. Revelation 1 verse 8. Revelation 21 verse 6. Revelation 22 verse 13. I'll take it again. I am Alpha, Omega, beginning and the ending. Revelation 1 verse 8. Revelation 21 verse 6. Revelation 22 verse 13. If you're with me, shout a loud amen.
Amen.
Number 9. What did Jesus say about himself, introducing himself to us? In Revelation chapter 1 and verse 17, he called himself the first and the last. I am the first, the originator and the culminator of all things. I am the first and the last. I am the first and the last. I am the first. That means everything, including what troubles you, came after me. I have the power to bring every, I am the first and the last. Whatever you face in your life did not precede Jesus. The only thing greater than Jesus must be what came before him. He said, I am the first and the last. Finally, what did he call himself? Revelation 1:18. Hallelujah. I am he that liveth. I was dead, but not forever. I am alive forevermore. I am he that liveth. I was dead, but only for 3 days. Make sure every time you talk about the Jesus who died, you remember that he only died for 3 days. In the name of Jesus Christ. And he says, I am alive forevermore. Amen. Are we learning? So Jesus had all this to say about himself. Called himself many beautiful names. The Word of God. Called himself the resurrection and the life. Do you know why he gave you all these options? Because the entire journey of your life will be, listen carefully, you will need all of these revelations of Jesus to survive your lifetime. He took out time to spread an understanding of himself such that there is no endeavor in life. Are we together now? As you sojourn through life, you must find a reason to need Jesus. If you don't need him as the resurrection and the life, you will need him as the door. If you don't need him as the door, one day you will need him as maybe the good shepherd. With these 10 descriptions of Jesus, there is no man on earth who is alive, who intends to live long, who will not face a challenge that only Jesus, by the description of himself, can solve. Did you get that now? If you reject the bread of life, you will need the light of the world. If you reject the light, you will need the door. If you reject the door, you will need the good shepherd. If you reject the good shepherd, you will need the resurrection and the life the day sickness comes upon your body. If you reject the resurrection and the life, you will, the confusion that plagues our world, you will need the way, the truth and the life. If you reject him, you will need the true vine. A time will come, you will be so confused about your life. That's when you will learn him as the Alpha, Omega, the beginning and the end. Are we together? And when you get to your final days on earth, it will be very comforting for you to know that he was the one who died, but now he is alive and lives forevermore. And he said this about himself: because I live, you will live also. This gives you hope beyond the grave. Are we learning now? Now, very quickly, I want us to examine why Jesus came. Why Jesus came? Why did he come? There are three principal assignments that represent Jesus's mission on earth. And if you do not understand this, the foundation of your Christian faith will be very faulty. And my Bible says, if the foundation be destroyed, it said, what can the righteous do? Are we ready? Number one, Jesus, his first assignment on earth was not even to die. You see that? His first assignment on earth was as an accurate revelation of the misunderstood God. Jesus came as a manuscript to correct our understanding of God. Until the manifestation of Jesus, nobody had an accurate understanding of God. So he came as a revelation and as a manifestation of the misunderstood God. In Hebrews chapter 11 from verse 1 to 3, the Bible says, God, who in sundry times and diverse manners spoke to us. Did I get that right? Hebrews chapter 1, my apologies, 1 to 3. God, who in sundry times and diverse manners spake to us in time past by the fathers, you know, and the prophets, hath in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he had appointed heir of all things, and by whom also he made the world. Verse 3, let's read it together. Who being the brightness of his, and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power. You can stop there. So the Bible tells us that Jesus came as a physical manifestation of God, who they had longed to see God. You know, before Jesus came, they only understood God through the lens of priests and prophets. Whatever priests and prophets told them God was, or God was saying, or God was doing, the people had to corporately believe it. Are we together? And through the lens of the prophets and the priests, you would see, using Jesus as a reference, that many of them did not do justice to the description of God. There were many things in the Old Testament that was credited to God that now, from the lens of Jesus, we know they made a mistake because they were humans. When you read the Bible entirely from the lens of the prophets and the priests, it will give you a very confusing description of God. It will be a blend of kindness and evil. It will be a blend. You will hear things like, an evil spirit departed from the Lord, and that statement will confuse you, because the entire nation of God's covenant people did not have the privilege of personal experience with God. Are we together? God will isolate an individual, whether Moses, whether Samuel, and have a covenant relationship with that person, and that person would have the mandate of revealing God to the people based on his experience. And Paul, mentoring us in 1 Corinthians 13, he said, we see in part and we prophesy in part. So it is a default in all men that no matter your level of alignment as a single individual, unassisted by the revelation of Jesus, you will not do justice to your knowledge of God. You would see the mix of divination and accurate prophetic manifestation even in the lives of ancient prophets, because many of them came from, you know, traditional practices and so on and so forth. It's important for you to get this background, because Jesus came as a correction to our understanding of God. That means he came as a marking script. How many of you know what a marking script is? A marking script is the reference that is used to mark every other script. So a teacher or a lecturer can tell someone, help me and mark this. He gives you a marking script. Are we together? You compare the answers that were written against the marking script is the reference. The first assignment of Jesus was to clarify the misunderstanding we had about God. And he did that by living his life. And before he, God had to accredit him and said, this is my beloved son. In other words, don't be afraid to hear him. He came from me. That means whatever Jesus did not do is not consistent with the character of God. It didn't matter what the prophet said. Did you get that now? Listen, if you do not understand God from the lens of Jesus, you will be confused. Demons will take advantage of scripture and deceive you. I hope you know that Satan also knows it is written. The devil will make you do many bad things having a scriptural reference. There are many believers in confusion as to their Christian experience today because they have, Jesus is not the focal point of their pursuit. And because of that, they are routing through different mechanisms in search for God. And the devil, knowing your zeal without an understanding of Jesus as the reference, he will use scripture to bring you into divination. And you will get there and not even know. All he needs to do is to show you where it was practiced in scripture. Did you get that now? There are herbalists today. If you go to the shrine, a Bible is part of the materials they used to con. And because you see a Bible there, you convince yourself that this must be God. So Jesus came to correct it. Are we following now?
I am confident that the sermons you've encountered have been a source of blessings, elevating your life and inspiring a heartfelt commitment to serving God wholeheartedly. We warmly invite you to subscribe to our YouTube channel, ensuring you stay connected and never miss any of our upcoming videos by activating the notification bell. Your subscription represents more than just a click. It signifies a commitment to continuous spiritual growth, enlightenment, and empowerment. Embark on this faith-filled journey with us as our channel aims to be a sanctuary for both spiritual seekers and believers alike. We firmly believe in the transformative power of God's Word, and our goal is to share messages that deeply resonate with your soul. Join our community, subscribe, and let the radiant light of divine wisdom illuminate your path. Thank you for being an integral part of this uplifting journey. And may God's abundant blessings overflow in your life. Amen. You can follow us on all our social media handles at Flaming Channel and visit our website at www.flamingchannel.com. Thank you. And may God bless you abundantly.